Hi, this is Dr. A, and in this anatomy and physiology review, we are going to look at the female reproductive system. So the functions of the female reproductive system are to produce the ova, or the egg, to provide a location for fertilization and a location for the development of the fetus. It also secretes the female sex hormones and produces milk to nourish the infant. The organs of the female reproductive system are the ovaries, the uterine, also known as fallopian tubes, the uterus, the vagina, vulva, and the breast. The female reproductive system consists of internal and external genitalia. The internal genitalia include the uterus, the ovaries, the two uterine or fallopian tubes, and the vagina. The external genitalia are collectively referred to as the vulva. Here is a diagram. We have the ovary right here. There's two of them, one on each side, right one, left one. And then there is also two fallopian tubes, a right one and a left one. And the fallopian tube leads from the ovary to the uterus. So here is the uterus right here. And then the exit of the uterus, or entrance to the uterus, I guess, would be the vagina. And then this is the vulva with the different labia. The ovaries are two almond-shaped glands that are on each side of the uterus. They produce and release an ovum about every 28 days. And this process of ovulation is prompted by the anterior pituitary hormones of LH and FSH. The ovaries also produce the sex hormones, estrogen and progesterone, at different levels during the cycle to help mature the egg and thicken the lining of the uterus. So here is the representation of an ovary, and in each ovary there are always follicles that are at different stages of maturation, such as there is one in each ovary that matures every 28 days. So we have a lot of primary follicles, and these then mature under the influence of estrogen into a maturing follicle where the ovum is developing here, and then it gets released. And then what is left behind in the ovary turns into the corpus luteum, which produces more progesterone and some estrogen too, but the progesterone then helps to maintain an early pregnancy if there's fertilization. And then after that luteal phase where the corpus luteum is active, and if there's no pregnancy, then it turns into the corpus albicans, and you know, the cycle repeats itself every 28 days. The uterine tubes transport the ovum from the ovary to the uterus. There are fimbriae near the ovaries that direct the ovum into the tubes that kind of move around and beat and try to coax it into the tubes. The tubes then propel the ovum to the uterus for implantation. Fertilization typically occurs in the upper half of the tube. So the ovum has left the ovaries and is entered into the fallopian tube somewhere at the beginning of the fallopian tube. That's if there is sperm present, that's where fertilization will happen. And then the fertilized egg is going to go down the fallopian tube and implant into the uterus. So here it is represented. So here's the egg cell, fimbriate. Egg cell is traveling down the uterine tube. It's going to travel all the way down, and somewhere in here there's fertilization that can happen. The uterus is a hollow pear-shaped organ in the center of the pelvic cavity. It is normally bent slightly forward in an anteflexion position. It can be subdivided into three parts: the fundus, or the upper portion of it, the corpus, or the central portion of it, and then the cervix, which is the neck of the uterus, or the lower portion of the uterus. The uterus is made up of three layers. The endometrium is the inner layer that has a rich blood supply. The endometrium is the layer that thickens for implantation and that is shed during the period. The myometrium is a middle layer of thick muscle that would be the layer that would contract during labor. And then the perimetrium is the outer layer that helps hold the uterus in position and anchor it in the pelvic cavity. If pregnancy is not established, then most of the endometrium is left off as the period or menstruation or the menstrual period. The first menstruation is menarche, and it occurs around 12 years of age. There are some variations there due to environment and genetics. The end of the menstruation and the childbearing years is menopause, and it can happen anywhere between ages 40 and 55. All right, so here is all the female reproductive system. So we have the ovaries right here on each side, an egg that is released, the fimbriae, fallopian tube, the egg would travel down the fallopian tube, and then it would embed itself in the endometrial layer here of the uterus, nice thick one. Here's the myometrium, the muscle layer, perimetrium, the outer layer. Here is the fundus, here's the body of the uterus, here is the cervix of the uterus, and then the vagina there. So the vagina is a thin muscular tube that is lined with mucous membrane. It extends from the cervix to the exterior, and it allows for the passage of menstrual flow. It receives the penis and semen during intercourse, and it serves as the birth canal for the child that is exiting. The hymen covers the external orifice, and Bartholin's glands provide lubrication for intercourse. The vulva is the general term for the structures of the external genitalia. The labia majora and minora are the skin folds that protect the genitalia, vaginal orifice, and the urinary meatus. The clitoris is the erectile tissue that is aroused during sexual stimulation. It's the equivalent of the penis in the male. And the perineum lies between the vaginal orifice and the anus. The breasts produce milk through the process of lactation to nourish an infant after childbirth. And milk is produced by the lactiferous glands, and it is carried to the nipple by lactiferous ducts. The areola is a pigmented area around the nipple. It is the area that the baby would latch on to nurse, and the breast will secrete milk as long as it is stimulated by a nursing infant. So as long as there's an infant feeding, milk will be produced. Pregnancy is a period of time during which the fetus develops in the uterus. Normal pregnancy length or gestation is around 40 weeks. From implantation through week 8, all the organs form and the baby is an embryo. And then from week 8 through birth, the organs mature and the baby is a fetus. And honestly, although now testing is such that often a woman can find out that she's pregnant early on, like at week 6 or 7, but it's, you know, by week 8, that baby is pretty much fully formed, as in all the organs, everything is already present, and then everything starts maturing from week 8 on through till the end, till birth. So the fetus receives nourishment by the way of a spongy blood-filled placenta. The placenta is an organ, and it is delivered following the birth of the baby. The umbilical cord attaches the fetus to the placenta, and then the placenta is anchored into the uterine wall of the mama. The amnion sac is the innermost of the two protective sacs, and the chorion is the outermost sac. And these are the sacs that are around the baby. Now here's an illustration of a developing embryo. Cute little guy or gal. And then here is an illustration of a fetus. So this is well past week 8. And you can see everything's maturing, very recognizable as a baby already. A full-term pregnancy with the baby fully grown and developed, you can see they should be head down, ready for childbirth. The cervix is going to be closed until it's time for childbirth, and then it's going to start facing and widening, etc. So let's talk a little bit about labor and delivery. So labor occurs in three stages. The first stage is dilation. So during dilation, the uterine muscles contracts strongly and expels the fetus. During dilation, those is when the labor contractions are really strong, and the woman can feel it, and contractions will get stronger and stronger and closer together until, you know, it's time to push. The fetus presses on the cervix, which causes it to dilate. So with its head's pressing down on the cervix. And as the cervix dilates, it becomes thinner through a process called effacement. So it goes, you know, it goes thinner, thinner, and then it opens up and until it's fully dilated so that the baby's head can pass through. So here is the dilation stage. So you can see the cervix here. Now there's an opening already. This is getting a lot thinner than it was in the previous illustration. And the baby's head is pushing, causing this effacement and dilation. The second stage is expulsion. So it begins when the cervix reaches 10 centimeter of dilation. So it's about this much there. It extends with the delivery of the baby. The baby's head usually appears first. That's what we want. And then once the baby is out and has been delivered, the last stage is the placental stage. It occurs immediately after birth, and it causes the expulsion of the placenta. And so here is the expulsion stage. The baby is being born. You can see the placenta is still there, but then the placenta will have to be birthed also. That one's pretty easy once the baby is out, though, because the placenta is definitely not nearly as big as the baby is. So. Anyway, so that wraps up our female reproductive system anatomy and physiology review.